Okay, we were talking about Isaiah 65:17, a refrigerator section that young children there should memorize, possibly. God is creating, in verse 18, a new Jerusalem for rejoicing. Sort of fun here, isn't it? Singing, you ain't seen nothing yet. We will not have the problems we have in the present time. And her people for gladness. And in 19, I will also, let's read round. Let's ask Barbara maybe to do 19 for us, and we'll go around the room, see what we have here. Just to repeat this section, then we'll get to 66.
19. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people, mm-hmm. and the sound of weeping and crying will be heard no more.
No longer will there be an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his days. For the youth will die at the age of 100, and the one who does not reach the age of 100 shall be thought accursed.
Mm-hmm.
They will build houses and inhabit them. They will also plant vineyards and eat their fruit.
They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. Mm-hmm.
They will not labor in vain or hear children for calamity or bear children mm-hmm. for calamity, mm-hmm. for they are the offspring of those blessed by the Lord.
Mm-hmm. And their descendants with them. Mm-hmm. Okay. 24.
It will also come to pass, before they call, I will answer, and while they're still speaking, I will hear.
And the wolf and the lamb will graze together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox, and dust will be the serpent's food. And they will do no evil or harm in all my holy mountain, says Yahweh, says the Lord God. Honestly, I mean, is there an argument here? People love to argue the Bible. I'm tired of arguments. This either has meaning or it doesn't, but the story of churches is that they managed to waffle away anything they didn't like. So this is vaguely, it's going to be okay, but vaguely, right? Everything's going to be okay. If words have any meaning at all, this shows that there are mortals in that future kingdom, doesn't it? And if they die at 100, they'll be considered kids. Well, how long did they live before the flood? Up to 1,000 years, nearly. Methuselah was, what, 950? After the flood went down a lot. So how old was Moses when he died? You all said?
120.
What? The person in the audience who knows 120. How old was Sarah? You would know that. 127. And Abraham was 175. That's pretty good. So if people die at the age of 100, isn't that amazing? Moses is said to have been with maximum vigor. His eyes were strong, he was reading well. That's 120. So that's your model, right? We can reproduce that to some extent today. Maybe we eat right and exercise right and think right. We might live a little bit longer that way. Drink lots of water, as my wife keeps telling me. So anyway, I think this is an amazing passage. The new heaven and the new earth is being described here. I don't think we're talking about the galaxies. You get my point. We're talking about society, what Peter calls the world of the past and the world of the present and the coming world. So history is periodized. Is that the word? Is periodized, I think that is the word. Three sections, from the creation right up to the flood. That was a new world after the flood, and it's going to be a new world when Christ comes back. It's very easy, but people have difficulty with that simple plan. I find that rather useful, liking simple things. So we're looking then at the new world coming, I think, unless you think this has been fulfilled already. And there are people on the internet who are quite convinced that Christ came back in AD 70. I mean, they're good people. They're not evil people. And they are just as dedicated and zealous as you are. But they're quite convinced that Christ came back in 70 AD. And I think, what is it? So you're living in the kingdom now. There are others who think the Great Tribulation began in 70 AD. So you're living in the Great Tribulation for 2,000 years. This is a madhouse. It drives us teachers almost insane. We get apoplectic, high blood pressure. Because come on, folks, can we not get this right? Come on, what is this mess? Anyway, shouldn't get carried away with that. I love 25, the wolf and the lamb will graze. That takes you back to Isaiah 11:6, doesn't it? We mentioned that last year, last week. And 11:6 has the same thing. That beautiful, idyllic picture of animals being tamed. So we're in that millennial, that pre-millennial thing now. We're not there yet, but when Christ comes back pre-millennially, this apparently is the scene. So show this to your friends in describing the kingdom. I think the kingdom is firstly this thing, right? It's a new world coming. That much we got right in the past. I don't know, what else can you do with this? Anybody want to say anything about it? Anybody writing to us about it? Anybody shaking their fist at this? It's very beautiful stuff. So, 66 then, the completion of the book of Yeshayahu Isaiah. So he's now speaking to us, Yahweh is, the one God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the one God of Jesus. Let me ask Bob on my left if he would read, or say, Barbara, we're going this direction today. Barbara could read verse 1 of 66.
This is what the Lord says, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Could you ever build me a temple as good as that? Could you build a dwelling place for me?
For my hand made all these things, thus all these things came into being, declares the Lord. But to this one I will look, to him who is humble and contrite of spirit and who trembles at my word.
But the transgressor that sacrifices a calf to me mm-hmm. is as he that kills a dog, mm-hmm. and he that offers fine flour as one that offers swine's blood. Mm-hmm. He that gives frankincense for a memorial is as a blasphemer. Yet they have chosen their own ways, and their soul has delighted in their abominations.
So I will choose their punishments, and will bring on them what they dread. Because I called, but no one answered. I spoke, but they did not listen. And they did evil in my sight, and chose that in which I did not delight.
Hear the word of the Lord, you who tremble at his word. Your brethren who hated you, who cast you out for my name's sake, let the Lord be glorified, that we may see your joy, but they may be ashamed.
A voice of uproar from the city, a voice from the temple, a voice of the Lord who is rendering recompense to his enemies.
Okay, let's stop there. The point in verse 3 then is that these people are offering sacrifices, but they might as well be killing a dog and doing it, you see? God is being appropriately sarcastic here. Killing an ox, they might as well just be like killing a man. You know, they're going to the temple to offer their sacrifice. They might just as well have committed a murder. It means nothing to me. Sacrifice without the truth is useless. And as it says at the end of 3, they've chosen their own ways. I'll do it my way. We were playing in the band the other day. I think that's Frank Sinatra. I'll do it my way. Yes, go for it. Try doing it God's way. It might be better. So then, in response to that, verse 4, I, God, will choose their punishments. He's not going to mess around. I'll bring on them what they dread. That's awful. Because I called and no one answered. I spoke and they didn't listen. That's interesting. That's the reverse of prayer. We're supposed to call on God and he answers. God calls on us and we don't reply or do, right? It's exactly the same language. You call on God, he calls on you. You either respond or don't. The story of mankind appears to be that we don't listen. Are people reading their Bibles? Are they just got a couple of verses on the fridge? That's not going to do it. 10-minute preaching and 15-minute singing is not going to do it. They're going to have to be reading whole sections of Scripture, I think, to get caught up in this world of the Bible. Maybe that's the way it works. Then he says, hear the word of the Lord in verse 5. Ye, those of you, rather, who tremble at his word. That's a good approach to Scripture. I'm somewhat, what would be the word, nervous when I read the Bible, when I read online this week that apparently up to 10 billion people might have died in the flood. That doesn't sound like a picnic to me. Jesus relates the second coming to the flood. Jesus is very conscious of the flood. And Lot's wife will look back, turn into a pillar of salt. I mean, do we really take those things seriously? That's rather scary. So, I'm trembling at those things, at the power of God. They did evil in my sight and chose that which I didn't delight in. Here it is, verse 5. Hear Yahweh's word, you who tremble at his word. Isn't that chapter 55? Just flick back to 55 and you'll see the same thing again. 55 is a theme that Isaiah seems to remember often. 55, I remember Barbara preaching on this in terms of eating good bread, bread that's not been manipulated, and we've made a very good point. 55. Ho, that's y'all come, right? Ho, wake up. Everyone who thirsts, 55:1, come to the waters, you have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money, without cost. Sounds like a good deal, doesn't it? Why are you spending your money for what isn't bread? You might say to the people eating deprived bread. What's the word? Deprived bread is not the right word. What's the word, Sarah?
Depleted bread.
So when you're choosing your bread at the supermarket, are you filling your stomach with depleted bread? On the spiritual level, then, what sort of spiritual nourishment are you getting? Why are you spending your money for what isn't really bread? And your wages, your hard-earned wages, for what really doesn't satisfy. Here's the solution then. Listen carefully to God, to me, and eat what is good, God says, and delight yourself in abundance. Incline your ear, come to me, listen that you may live. How about that? Listen and live. That's a good refrigerator line, isn't it? Listen and live. Don't listen and die. Believe things that are false and poison yourself. Put the cyanide in your coffee. Go ahead. You want to believe things that are false, like the tribulation began in 70 AD, or that Jesus came back in 70 AD, or that he came back in 1914, or that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. Believe that and go for it, but you're poisoning yourself. So we have to then reach out to people who have been caught in these errors. Listen and live. And I'll make an everlasting constitution with you. I think maybe that's the best word these days for covenant. Constitution is about right, because people understand that the final appeal in America is always the Constitution, isn't it? The Constitution is it. That's good. You need a standard. But covenant is about the same thing. God's arrangement with man as a legal binding covenant constitution. I will make an everlasting constitution with you following the instructions or the faithful mercies shown to David. What are those? That's a bit vague. What does this constitution involve? The faithful kindnesses given to David. What are they? I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader, and a commander for the peoples. You want to be leaders and commanders? Go for it. That's what you're offered. That's what David has promised. I think, actually, that makes good sense. We all want to fix the world, don't we? We all want to fix the world. Go for it. Fix the world a little bit now. You can. Not totally, but fix the world on a grand scale. That's what David is going to do. That's what Christ, the new David, is going to do. And verse 5, behold, you will call a nation you don't know. Imagine telling the Syrians, get over here and listen. The whole of the Syrian nation. Come on, let's get this right. You come and listen to what God has to say. Tell the Egyptians to get straight. I mean, there's a lot of straightening out. Obviously, it has to be done. A nation which knows you not will run to you would apply to restored Israel, the nation. The now currently blinded natural Jew is going to get his eyes open, a remnant of them. They will be leaders in the kingdom too. Because of the Lord your God, even the Holy One of Israel, because he will have glorified you. He hasn't glorified you yet, but come the time of the second coming, you will be glorified. You will have been glorified. Stand there as an immortal person in that kingdom, and you've got some power now. They want to build a tank to kill somebody. You can stop that. Isn't that marvelous? Wouldn't you love to do that now? You don't have that kind of power, but you will. So that's the little excursus then. Going on into the thing about hungering and thirsting for God's word, and that's the same theme as we saw in chapter 66, it seems to me.
This,
yes.
This verse about the way.
Yes.
Where is it?
The way.
In 66?
Yeah,
63.
63, was it?
They've chosen their own way.
Yes.
Yeah, it reminds me of that proverb that says that there's a way that seems right,
mm-hmm. right.
Mm-hmm. to a person, but yes. it's. And is death.
Mm-hmm.
So this is where we need discernment, right?
Absolutely.
And the Spirit of God, because there's many ways that seem ethically,
yes,
morally,
that's right.
right, and they're offered that's to right. you by many different
that's right.
systems of belief.
Yeah.
And you know, you look at the way and go, wow, it looks good and it's ethical, moral,
absolutely.
And sound.
Exactly right. That's a proverb that those of us from the Armstrong days heard often. There's a way that seemeth right, you know, King James in those days, like, it seems right to go to church on Sunday, but watch out. You ain't keeping the Sabbath, fourth commandment, you better do it. That seemed very right. Now I think it's very wrong, as reading the whole book of Galatians this morning. Amazing stuff. The whole book of Galatians, he's impassioned. He says, listen, if you go and get circumcised, you will be obliged to keep the whole law. Don't do it. In those days, I should have said, what's that whole law that I shouldn't be keeping? Didn't get it right. It's 14 years of our lives. So, yes, there's a way that sounds good.
Jesus going before the commandment, rest on that.
Yes, but wait a minute. Paul also said, if you get circumcised, it's in Galatians 4, then you're obliged to keep the entire law. For goodness sake, don't go there. Don't worry about the tassels. That's not going to do you any good. Don't worry about the food laws. They're not the main issue, that sort of thing. It's very powerful. Paul isn't passionate there. He doesn't want the church to be ruined. You know, he's terribly keen to preserve their freedom. And then he's so strong that he even says that the Sinai event is bondage. You want to keep the Ten Commandments and the letter? Go for it. And be in bondage. Isn't that amazing stuff? He has to really make his point strongly, I think. But we didn't get that clear. I think now we're enjoying more of the freedom. So you're right about the way that seems right. It sounds awfully good. The Ten Commandments are like, surely that's got to be the ultimate thing. Everybody said, well, wait, no, Paul did say that keeping Sinai in the letter is actually like Hagar and bondage.
So what would be your advice for someone who happens to come to this video online who's not like-minded? And so what would be the advice? I mean, if it looks good and it sounds good, I mean, you know, most, as we know, most other denominations, Christian denominations, they're not teaching beheadings or fornication or... Yeah. It's interesting to me because denominations, regardless of their Christian affiliation, one thing they abhor is sexual immorality, and that's across the spectrum. So it's a universal condemnation. So what can we say to someone that, you know, this church or that church is teaching good things? Why should I leave, or why should, you know?
It's a lot of various topics, I think, there in your comments. Obviously, we're always trying to get it right.
Right.
A church that insists that you must keep the holy days, new moons, and even be circumcised is simply wrong. Paul is aghast at that idea. If you insist on keeping the food laws, it's simply just going to put you into the old covenant. That's what Paul is so scared of, is mixing the covenants, going back under the old covenant. He then says Christ will be no good to you. Forget your Christianity. It's not going to work. You're poisoning yourself. But it seems to be right, because after all, the Ten Commandments, Jesus even said to the young man who asked, what shall I do? He said, well, keep the commandments. That's a good start, good place to start. But if you read on into Paul, and I know my colleague here, Brian, is dealing with people on the internet like this, they're convinced that Paul was completely wrong. We've got correspondents who are absolutely sure that Jesus was the Messiah, but that Paul was a ghastly false prophet, because Paul is so radical with the law. So all you can do is argue with them, honestly, argue in a decent way.
I think it's a good chapter to read in relationship. Galatians is Acts 15. That's helped me more than anything where Paul talks. I mean, Peter talks about the yoke.
Yes.
Our forefathers couldn't bear it. We can't bear it.
A good point.
And we're not going to teach the Gentiles that they have to be circumcised to be saved. That was the big issue right there. And if you read the four things they require, and they said, you do good. They name those four things. And you're doing well if you do those four things when they went to the Gentiles.
That's a great point.
To me, you have to tie that in with the book of Galatians.
Absolutely.
That helped me get straightened out.
Why don't we just very good, because you brought out one of the most stinging points in Acts 15.
Yeah, I think it was.
It's which verse that is that?
They insisted they be circumcised to be saved.
Absolutely, that was the argument. You had to be circumcised and keep the whole law that goes with it. Don't forget Paul's phrase, if you get circumcised, then you're going to have to keep the whole law. So where's the one about the yoke that we couldn't...
Are we at 15?
That's it.
Acts 15.
15, yeah. And which verse? Acts 15, which is the yoke verse.
Talks about a yoke,
so... 10. Oh, yes,
10.
10. Yep, that's 10. Now, therefore, why... This is the argument. Why do you put God to the test? You don't want to do that. By placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke which neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear. It's very, very strong, because the Jews said the Torah is wonderful. Right? It was, but it was also a yoke. That's a very powerful point, isn't it? I actually don't think most commentators understand that Paul, as a Jew, is not in favor of circumcision even for Jews. That's going further than most are willing to do. But if you insist on physical circumcision for Jewish Christians, you divide the church in a way. They've all got to get certain. I don't think so. Paul in Galatians says, let me tell you, all of you, I'm speaking to all of you now. I'm sure there were some Jews in the audience. If there weren't, he's making it very confused. I want to tell everybody, every one of you, that if you get circumcised, Christ will be of no effect. The whole lot. That is very radical, isn't it? I feel there's a freedom there. Glad you raised that text, with that one about the yoke is very significant. Peter says that the law was a yoke. Of course, it was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, and now you are no longer under that schoolmaster. Anyway, good
and
good excursus there.
To very add good. To that, verse 11,
yes.
The fact that we are all saved the same way.
Absolutely.
I mean, that will absolutely undo, yes. I would have thought, you know, people keeping the old covenant.
That's right. Yeah, if anybody's dealing with friends who are wondering about this, you go to Genesis 17 sometime, and you will see that you had to be physically circumcised, Jews and Gentiles, to be part of the covenant. You could be a sort of a semi-believer in Israel by not being circumcised, but if you wanted to be part of God's true people as a Gentile, you had to be physically circumcised. That's what it says. All those foreigners who came to Israel, if they wanted to be part of the covenant people, that is clearly not what Paul said, isn't that right? That's the starkest way of showing the difference between the new covenant and the old, isn't it? Here it says you've got to be circumcised or die. Here it says you better not be circumcised or die, right? That's very hard for people, but we work at it. Freedom. Certainly, I think from our own experience, life seems to go better now than those days when we were on the old law. But that's a subjective judgment.
Just on the yoke thing, Anthony. There's the prophecy in just to go back to Isaiah.
Yeah.
This time, chapter 10.
Yeah.
About the remnant. It talks about the remnant.
Yeah.
Since we're looking at end days here as well.
Yeah.
So, and then in verses 20 onward, it talks about this remnant that will come back to the land, and God will restore them. And then in verse 26 and 27. So it will be in that day that his burden will be removed from your shoulders, and his yoke from your neck.
That's right.
And the yoke will be broken because of fatness. Does that have to do with
not the yoke of the law? We're talking about a different yoke there. In that context, we've got the Assyrian yoke, the final attackers of Israel, called the Assyrians in Isaiah. The day is coming when that frightful captivity, that terrible enslavement of Israel, will be removed. Right. Fatness, the Jews take that to be a reference to Messiah, and exactly I've forgotten the detail, but Messiah's presence with them in that future day will be the end of the Assyrian burden. That's very important. Not Rome, by the way, but the Assyrian is the enemy in Isaiah and in Micah. In Micah 5, you'll find that Jesus is going to deliver the Jews from the Assyrian. That's never happened, so that's interesting stuff. We've got an article, I think, at the site called The Assyrian in Messianic Prophecy. It deals with that. So, yes, there's another burden, you're right. One burden was the law, wasn't it? Here's another burden. Israel is going to be enslaved to an Assyrian invader. That presumably is the king of the north. Exactly which nation today, not quite clear, because Assyria is a somewhat fluid thing. In Ezra 6:22, it speaks of Iran being Assyria. So that's included. I don't know how that works exactly. But some sort of a northern confederacy led by the Assyrians, Psalm 83. All of that's being done rather well by many evangelicals these days.
One thing is for sure, though, it's from the north.
It's what?
One thing is for sure,
yes.
It's from the north.
That's right.
Not the east, not the west.
That's right. It's from the north. The north is always where the bad things
north
come.
North of Israel.
And of course, to come to Israel from the north, you could come from the east. You had to go north and then come south. So it's north in some sense. At least they have to arrive from the north, which suggests the king of the north in Daniel chapter 11. Okay, so that's that story. And then we go back to Isaiah 66. Good stuff. 7, verse 7. Who's going to read verse 7? All right, please.
Before she travailed, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she gave birth to a boy.
Who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Can a land be born in one day? Can a nation be brought forth all at once? As soon as Zion travailed, she also brought forth her sons. Verse 9.
Would I ever bring this nation to the point of birth and then not deliver it, asked the Lord? No, I would never keep this nation from being born, says your God.
Okay, let's stop there. Isn't that marvelous? This is the new birth of the world. Matthew 19, 28 goes in your margin there. I love this passage. It's so real and so unchurchy. Matthew 19, 28, Peter says rather forlornly, oh, we're really up against it, Jesus. These people hate us. This church establishment really despises us. Matthew 19, 28. And Peter says, what's in it for me? And Jesus didn't say, you idiot, don't ask silly questions like that. God loves you, get on with it. No. He doesn't. He answers in a very realistic way. He says, in the new birth of the world, that's the reborn world, the new created earth of the future, the new heavens and new earth, when that time comes, and let me put in parentheses, the Jews thought that when Noah stepped out of the ark, he was in the rebirth of the world. He was. That world was reborn after the flood. Going to be reborn again. So when that happens, Jesus said, you who have followed me are going to be promoted to sit on 12 thrones to administer the 12 tribes of Israel. Isn't that marvelous? The regathered remnant of natural, now blinded Israel are going to be reassembled, and you apostles are going to take charge of this mess. I think, what else does it mean? I find that quite brilliant. I don't think we had sermons on that in the Church of England, as far as I remember. Maybe we did, and I was sleeping. But I don't remember any of that. So that's the rebirth that's being talked about here. The world is going to be born again. Now, you come into it this way. You'd better be born again in advance of that, you see. If you want to be part of the reborn world when it comes, then you get born again now. Armstrong had us fooled to some extent. He said, well, you could just be forgotten in the womb, but you couldn't be. That's wrong. You're born again now. You're a newborn babe desiring the milk of the word. That's not the fetus, by the way. James 1:18 says that God has begotten us. There's a woman image. Has brought us forth. Has, pass it. Has brought us forth. James 1:18, and Peter there speaks about being born again. Now, you've got to be born again now in order to see the kingdom when it comes. So that's how we are part of that reborn world in the future. We're the avant-garde, if that's the right word. We're the sort of advance guard in preparation for the rebirth of the whole world. And if, you know, can you do this in one day? Well, you watch, is it? Is God going to bring to the point of birth and not? No, of course not. He's going to rebirth the whole nation of Israel. And we're that Israel internationally now, reborn before the second coming. So, now we have joy in Jerusalem's future, is the heading. Who's going to read 10?
Me.
Please.
Be joyful with Jerusalem and rejoice for her, all you who love her. Be exceedingly glad with her, all you who mourn over her.
So that you may suck and be satisfied with the breast of her consolation, that you may milk out and delight yourselves with the influx of her glory.
Wow.
For thus says Yahweh, behold, I extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. And you will be nursed, you will be carried on the hip and fondled on the knees.
And as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you.
Okay, let's pause right there. That's wonderful.
Can I finish? Then,
yeah, we have, sorry, finish the
verse. Finish the verse.
And you will be comforted in Jerusalem now?
Yeah, that one.
Hit
it. But then you did it.
Okay. Now, you know that texts are supposed to attract, like, filings to a magnet.
Bringing the pearls.
Yes, stringing the pearls, absolutely. Join the dots. You're all hearing those marvelous songs in Luke, aren't you, about peace in Jerusalem. They're looking, waiting for the comfort of Jerusalem. Mm. They're looking for this event. Mm. That's what every proper Bible believer does, is to long for the coming of Messiah and peace on earth. Isn't it wonderful?
Like Joseph of
Arimathea was waiting for the kingdom.
Waiting for her consolation.
The consolation of Israel, the comfort of Israel. Blessed are those who mourn. You see the language here. Jesus, your rabbi, was filled with this stuff. He lives out of this material. He read the book of Isaiah, as we know. So this comfort image is wonderful. And then he uses all the pictures he can get. The mother. I don't get to see babies very often. We did have a baby in the house. I've forgotten what babies do. You just don't know until you get with them.
It's been a while.
This baby we had in the house gurgled, smiled, cried, tossed around, and I thought, this little mite is so defenseless. And then mother came back, you know, the images are very powerful, but you have to experience that. You have to see it face to face. So I think this is a very clever way to teach, isn't it?
Well, you know, even animals, you can just see like puppies and kittens, mm-hmm. when they are nursing, they are just like in another world.
That's true.
Did you all see the video of the cat that rescues the boy from the dog? That is one of the most